Good morning, Eastside. I hope you all had a great week. And I just want to let you know that things are changing in Williamsburg and for Eastside. The governor has allowed us to do a little bit more. And so please make sure you check the website for details. We're still working out what that looks like. But hopefully there will be some small changes. Our number one priority is keeping everybody healthy and safe. But I think we can come up with some creative ways where we could worship together, maybe a little more together than this. So please keep looking at the website for details, because things will be changing. As we go into this time, we move into our time of confession like we do every week. I just had this verse on my heart this week from Psalm 18, starting at verse 16. He reached down from on high and took hold of me. He drew me out of deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes who were too strong for me. They confronted me in the day of my disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into a spacious place. He rescued me because he delighted in me. And I feel like when we confess our sins, we are able to go out into that spacious place that he wants us to be in, instead of confined and weighed down by our own sin. And so as we go into our time of confession, wherever God is leading you this morning, just take a moment and surrender to him and confess. So would you bow with me in confession, in a silent time of confession? Father, thank you that you delight in us, that it is your will for us, that it is your desire for us to be in a spacious place. Thank you for forgiveness. Thank you for Jesus, for rescuing us, and for continuing to rescue us in every moment that we turn to you and ask for forgiveness. So Father, we come now, and with grateful hearts, we are pleased to worship you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we're going to go into a time of worship, and I do hope that we can go into that time just with lightened hearts, that we can feel the weight gone and his joyful presence with us.
It is well, it is well. trial should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my
song that Reed led us in to open our service, Christ Lives in Me, might remind some of you of the passage that we read last week, Galatians 2, verses 20 to 21, that I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life that I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. At this point, we're going to go ahead and transition into the Lord's Prayer, a prayer that we pray every time we gather together. And I just want to point out that the Lord's Prayer and the words of that song in Galatians 2:21, they're all closely tied. That in the Lord's Prayer, where we ask, Father, your will be done, we understand that His will is that we live this life in Christ, that we die to our old way of life, and we now allow Christ to live in us with the understanding that this will mean taking up our cross just like Jesus took up his cross. This will mean carrying each other's burdens, that not every time as we're walking through his will, it's certain that it won't always be comfortable or joyful in and of itself, but that always in the end we know it's good because we trust our Heavenly Father, that it is well with our soul, that your will be done. We just can't go back to that way of life we had on our own that didn't work. That, Lord, carrying the cross for sure takes resolution and commitment and discipline, that it's difficult, but that we're not alone, and in the end, it's good. So would you please join with me as we pray the prayer that our Lord Jesus Christ taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we're going to hear a testimony from our friend Jinx. So here's Jinx.
Hello, I'm Jinx Babby. I am a widow and an attender at Eastside Church, and I'm going to share some difficulties and what God has shown me through the COVID-19 pandemic. In the early March, I had to scramble for several weeks and move our Bible study fellowship class to online and to Zoom from in-class meeting. And it took a while, and it was a scramble. And I was very busy during those few weeks. But once it began to run smoothly, I had time to do other things, and I became very unsettled, was starting to think, how do I help people through this? How do I reach out? How do I function? I'm so used to being on the go and reaching out and, you know, interjecting or interconnecting with people and trying to be a help to different people. And I just couldn't figure it out. It was becoming very uncertain and very uncomfortable for me. So I started to think about last summer. I had a very profound disappointment, a deep hurt that happened to me. I received an email and I was just crushed by the email. I don't think it was intended to hurt, but it was a profound hurt, and I burst into tears, and that's not typical for me. I generally I don't take offense easily. I don't get hurt easily. I don't cry much. I really don't. So it was a profound hurt, and I was devastated, and I did not know what to do about it. I didn't want to call a friend. I didn't have anything to talk about. I was just hurt. So I went to the Word, and I went to prayer, and I began to read the Psalms, and just began to really immerse myself in the Word and in prayer. And I did that all afternoon, that evening. The next morning, I got up, did it again. Well, by the mid-morning, I was beginning to be able to feel that God was showing me. One of my life verses was really prominent in my mind, James 1, verse 2. We are to count it all joy when we encounter trials. And I thought, what is this? I'm now thinking to myself, that's always been a great scripture, but I'm thinking to myself, how normal is that for us to count it joy when we're in the middle of a trial? And I did not feel like counting this joyful at all. And I was feeling very sorry for myself and very hurt. Well, as I continued to pray and read the Word, I became joyful. It was unbelievable how I became joyful. I actually started to rejoice in the Lord. He changed my perspective. He caused me to be able to see that, yes, this was a profound hurt. I was not imagining things. It was a deep hurt. But on the other hand, I had some things that I could change in my life that he was trying to show me. And one was that I needed to repent of some disrespect and some insensitivity and some pride. I needed to repent. I needed to turn away from that. And I needed to ask some forgiveness, which it took me a day or two before I was able to do that. But, you know, I relied on God for it. And he also began to impress upon me that I was to understand that God works all things together for good for those who love him or are called according to his purpose. That's Romans 8:28. That's another amazing scripture that pulls me through just about anything. And I thought, okay, then he's going to call use this to work good in my life and work glory for himself. So, okay. So he began to change my perspective and show me where changes needed to be made in different circumstances and relating to this disappointment. And I was able to come through it with some new perspectives and some joy. Unbelievable. So anyway, fast forward to the pandemic. Here I am befuddled and discombobulated about what to do, how to live my life now. And I began to think about that experience last summer, and I thought, it's the same thing. I'm to count this all joy. Because if you read the rest of the scripture through verses about 6 or so, James 1, 2 through 5 or 6, it goes on to talk about what it develops in our character. And I want those things in my character. I want those developed in me. And I thought, well, how can this help? How can I count this trial joy? What can I see from it that God is going to use to work it for my good and for his glory? And I began to see all the ways, the creative new ways that he will give me, that he has given me, to reach out to my family, to my grandchildren, to others in my life that I care about, to some of my sick friends that are unbelievers. Just new creative ways, and Lord was giving them to me. So I just thought, all right, I'm counting it all joy, Lord, and I am trusting you to work all of this together for good and for your glory. Thank you for letting me share.
Thank you, Jinx. At this time in our service, we would normally take the offering and give some announcements. So we can't take the offering, but I still can give a couple announcements. If you are interested in giving, please go to the website, and at the bottom of the homepage, you'll see a place where you can hit giving and find out all you need on how you can give it if you'd like. Also at that homepage, what you can find near the bottom of the homepage also is a video by Ashley Willis. Ashley leads our Turning Point ministry. And what Ashley has done in her video is just given some thoughts on how we might be able to process fear. Just constantly being peppered with fear, maybe even more so during these times of the coronavirus, and even now talking about coming out of the complete isolation. You heard Karen mention it, that even as a church, we're trying to figure out what that looks like. And thinking of staying in quarantine is scary. Coming out can feel scary. So what do we do with this fear? And you might find Ashley's video helpful. I thought it was very insightful. And that's on the homepage near the bottom if you're interested. Also wanted to let you know that Reed, who opened us this service, leads us every Friday at 2 o'clock in a time of worship. If you'd like to know more about that, please go to the website again. And at the very top of the homepage, you'll find that there's some slides scrolling across the top. If you click on the one there with the guitar, you'll see some information on how you can join us on Fridays at 2 if you'd like a time of worship where Reed leads us live and a time through Facebook and Instagram. And so I hope you're able to join us. We're going to now transition to our students, the time where we try to encourage our students to recite memory verses for us. So here's what we have for you this week from the students.
Galatians 5, 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, grace, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such thing there is no law.
Galatians 5, 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Against such thing there is no law.
Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 to 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law.
Thank you, students. Our scripture for today is Acts chapter 15, verses 1 through 22. Acts 15, 1 through 22. Reads, some men came down from Judea to Antioch and were teaching the brothers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom taught by Moses, you cannot be saved. This brought Paul and Barnabas into sharp dispute and debate with them. So Paul and Barnabas were appointed, along with some other believers, to go up to Jerusalem to see the apostles and elders about this question. The church sent them on their way, and as they traveled through Phoenicia and Samaria, they told how the Gentiles had been converted. This news made all the brothers very glad. When they came to Jerusalem, they were welcomed by the church and the apostles and elders, to whom they reported everything God had done through them. Then some of the believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees stood up and said, the Gentiles must be circumcised and required to obey the law of Moses. The apostles and elders met to consider this question. After much discussion, Peter got up and addressed them. Brothers, you know that some time ago God made a choice among you that the Gentiles might hear from my lips the message of the gospel and believe. Remember, that was back in Acts chapter 10 when Peter was sent to Cornelius' house, and as he's preaching to them, the Holy Spirit came on all the Gentiles in Cornelius' house. God, who knows the heart, showed that he accepted them by giving the Holy Spirit to them, just as he did to us. He made no distinction between us and them, for he purified their hearts by faith. Now then, why do you try to test God by putting on the necks of the disciples a yoke that neither we nor our fathers have been able to bear? No, we believe it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we are saved, just as they are. The whole assembly became silent as they listened to Barnabas and Paul telling about the miraculous signs and wonders God had done among the Gentiles through them. When they finished, James spoke up. Brothers, listen to me. Simon, Peter, has described to us how God at first showed his concern by taking from the Gentiles a people for himself. The words of the prophets are in agreement with this, as it is written. And then he quotes Amos chapter 9. After this, here's the quote, after this I will return and rebuild David's fallen tent. Its ruins I will rebuild, and I will restore it, that the remnant of men may seek the Lord, and all the Gentiles who bear my name, says the Lord who does these things that have been known for ages. It is my judgment, therefore, that we should not make it difficult for the Gentiles who are turning to God. Instead, we should write to them, telling them to abstain from food polluted by idols, from sexual immorality, and from meat of strangled animals and from blood. For Moses has been preached in every city from the earliest times and is read in the synagogues on every Sabbath. Then the apostles and elders with the whole church decided to choose some of their own men and sent them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. They chose Judas, called Barsabbas, and Silas, two men who were leaders among the brothers. This is the word of the Lord. Last Sunday on Mother's Day, I got a text at 8 in the morning from a friend of mine who sent me a verse. And she actually sent it to both Karen and I in a text. And she said, I want you to have this verse. And it was Ruth chapter 2, verse 12. And she said, I'm not even sure what this means to you or might mean to you exactly. I'm just convinced that the Holy Spirit wants me to send this to you, that God wants me to send you this text, this verse. And so I looked at the verse, and the verse is, like I said, Ruth chapter 2. And what's going on in Ruth chapter 2 is this godly man, Boaz, is talking to this godly woman, Ruth, and he says to her, may the Lord pay you for all your work. May he reward you or compensate you. And because you have sought shelter under his wings. It's essentially what the verse says. You have found refuge under the Lord's wings, under his wings. Now, as soon as I read that verse, I asked her, have you already listened to the sermon, which I had recorded earlier in the week, but that was now online. It was Sunday morning, 8 a.m. It's online by then, at least often. I thought maybe she'd heard the sermon. And she said no. And I said, well, that's pretty amazing to me, because in the sermon, I quoted Matthew 23:37, where Jesus is looking out over Jerusalem and says, O Jerusalem, O Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how long or how often I have longed to gather your children like a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. But you were not willing. You were not longing for this. You didn't want this. You weren't willing. It blew my mind because it's the only verse that I can think of in the whole New Testament, only verse that talks about Jesus wanting to gather his people under his wings. And then I got this verse from Ruth chapter 2, which I'm sure I've read at some point, but I don't remember at all, any reference to Boaz telling Ruth, you've sought shelter under his wings. And what it did for me when I read it was just kind of this comfort, this peace, this blessing, this reminder that that's really where I am. That sometimes I think it's too good to be true, that I could be under Jesus' wing, that my Heavenly Father, I've really found refuge and I'm safe with him, that all this anxiety that I might be feeling from coronavirus or a million other questions that existed before coronavirus that I don't have answers for, you know, as we think about what are we doing in the neighborhood and how do we be a blessing to the neighborhood and how do we bless each other? What should I be doing? I don't know. And it was just kind of like, peace. I've got you. I really am gathering you like a hen gathers her chicks under my wing. That you have refuge with me. So once I found out she hadn't heard the sermon, I just told her, I quote that verse. And it was just a huge blessing for me. And she wrote back, wow, that helps me understand more about why God might want me to send you that verse. And have a wonderful day with the refuge you have under his wings. It's just a real blessing. So why do I mention that to you, that little story, as we read Acts 15? Because what I think that story says to me and what I think James actually stood up and said at the end of this debate they were having in Jerusalem, probably right around 48 AD or something, a couple thousand years ago, what I believe James got up and said was, God has blessed us as part of his plan to bless the world. And what I saw in that friend's text was, wow, God has really blessed you. He has poured out his spirit into your heart and mind. He is moving you to send me verses that mean something special to me on this morning, that you would send that to me. And that it was just such a blessing to me. And that's what God does, that he blesses us so that we might be a blessing to other people. That God has blessed us as part of his plan to bless the world. Which James, right, in verses 16 and 17 of Acts chapter 15 there, he quotes Amos. And what he says is, look, what we're seeing with all God's miraculous works that we're hearing about, that we've witnessed, that we're experiencing, is that God really has rescued us from under the curse of the law. That we had disobeyed. The law was good. It promised blessings if we'd obey, but curses if we disobeyed. And we had disobeyed, and we were under the weight of the curse. But we're experiencing the blessing. The Holy Spirit's been poured out on us because Jesus Christ became a curse for us. Just like Paul said to the Galatians, right? We talked about last week. Chapter 3, verses 13 and 14, that Jesus became a curse for us. And saved us, rescued us from the weight of the law. Why? So that we might receive the promised Holy Spirit. We might be blessed, yes, but also so that the Gentiles might receive the blessing of Abraham through Jesus Christ. That these blessings go together. That yes, we've been blessed. James is saying, look, the tent of David is being rebuilt. Jesus, the son of David, has restored the tent of David. David, who was supposed to have an heir sit on the throne forever, he's not on the throne anymore during James' day. There's nobody sitting on the throne and on David's throne. The emperor of Rome is in charge. But what's James say? No, no. The tent of David's been restored. Jesus Christ is enthroned in heaven. And he is the son of David, excuse me, the Messiah and the son of God. And not only does James point out that, hey, this Amos prophecy says that we'll be blessed. It says that Gentiles will be blessed too. That all who were called by his name, the Gentiles too. James is saying essentially the same thing Paul said in writing to the Galatians, that the blessing to the believing Jews is tied together with the blessing that's now being poured out on the whole world, all the Gentiles, the non-Jews, so Jews and non-Jews, all receiving the blessing of Abraham. Now, James says, God has blessed us as part of his plan to bless the world. That this blessing that my friend has, like she displayed it in miniature, what's going on worldwide, right? That those who are being blessed by God, receiving the Holy Spirit, are now blessing the world around us. That's the plan. God has blessed us as part of his plan to bless the world. All right. Well, that's a big task. It's actually the one line I want you to remember at the end of this sermon. God has blessed us as part of his plan to bless the whole world. Well, where do we start? Where can we start in this mission to bless the whole world, or at least the portion of the world that God has made available to us? How do we bless it? Well, I want to say to begin with, we have to know we are blessed. That's a funny thing, isn't it? We can forget easily that we are blessed. We can forget that the Holy Spirit has cleansed us of past sins. Right, we can forget that we are cleansed by the sacrifice that Jesus made in giving himself up for us on the cross. We've been forgiven. We can forget it and just feel old guilt. We can forget that we are empowered to hear God's voice and to move forward in obedience. We can forget last night, I woke up again in the middle of the night feeling shame. This time for not even anything that I did wrong, nothing immoral. You know what I remembered? I remembered an old game that I played in where I struck out twice. That's kind of weird, right? I woke up in the middle of the night ashamed that I had struck out twice. I just don't think the Lord's looking to put any shame on me. Never mind shame for striking out 30 years ago. It's probably from like 1990, you know, 30 years ago. No, it's the enemy's work. And he's always looking to shame God's people. He wants us to forget that we are blessed. But the first step we got to know before we can go bless the world around us is that we are blessed. Our shame has been removed. That when we turn and confess our sins, God is merciful and just and kind and will forgive us of our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Hebrews 12:2 says, Jesus Christ says, fix your eyes on Jesus Christ, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the Father. That he scorned the shame of the cross. Where did that shame come from? Jesus hadn't done anything shameful. He took on our shame. He took on the cross and our shame, and he bore it, absorbed it, and overcame it, that he could remove the shame from our lives when we turn and confess. That not only do I not have to feel shame for a striking out, like, hey, I didn't even do it on purpose. But I don't even have to feel shame for those things that I did that were honestly shameful. Like, they were dark and wrong and selfish and damaging. That it was right to feel shame in the moment, but that when I turn to Jesus and say, Lord, I'm so sorry, forgive me, and I believe in my heart, no, this is not what I want. I want to follow you. Show me how I can make amends. What can I do? I'll do it. He removes that shame and guilt. No, we are blessed. And the first step in being a blessing to those around us is we must understand that we are blessed. And remember what Paul said. He said, the life I live in the body, I no longer live for myself, but I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That we live by the Spirit, a life by the Spirit. Jesus has poured out his Holy Spirit into our lives. We are blessed. You couldn't be more blessed. Christ in you. The hope of glory. Step one, we are blessed. Step two, in being a blessing to the world around us, it's all over what the verses we read. And I want to say the next step is we bless the world around us by humbly listening together for God's leading. That is the next step. That what we see going on in chapter 15 the whole way through is everybody is listening to everybody else as they try to figure out how does God want to answer this? Or maybe a better question or a better way to put it is, how has God already answered this question? See, because what they're doing, right, they got this problem. Do the Gentiles, the people who are believers, it says, from the Pharisees' party are saying, no, it's not just believing in Christ. You have to be circumcised and obey the law. And so they're like, hey, what does everybody think here? Like, there's a split, there's a divide, a disagreement, which in and of itself isn't bad. As long as everyone will humbly listen together, it can be helpful. So what happens? Well, they gather in Jerusalem, where these guys were originally came from, that went out and stirred the church at Antioch, where Paul and Barnabas were. Paul and Barnabas, the church in Antioch, sends them down So they agree, hey, next step, hey, let's just send you down. Let's go have a discussion down there with everybody. And on the way down, as soon as they get there, Paul and Barnabas start sharing what God did. What God did among the Gentiles while they were out on their first missionary trip in Acts 13 and 14, right? Out in Galatia and a couple other places before that. So here's what God already did. That he did miracles and brought people to faith. These Gentiles are believing. He did that and they weren't circumcised. So I don't think God's saying they got to be circumcised, right? So Paul and Barnabas share what God's done. And then Peter gets up and says, hey, you guys remember that God had me speak to the Gentiles at Cornelius' house, and the Holy Spirit was poured out on them. They weren't circumcised, so it doesn't make sense if God's saying, hey, I see their hearts, and I've cleansed them, forgiven them, and poured out my Spirit on them. They believe. If God is letting them in, then we can't say they have to be circumcised now to get in. It doesn't make any sense. And then Paul and Barnabas share more. And then finally, James stands up and says, hey, we've heard what Peter said. And everybody just sat around and listened to Paul and Barnabas. And remember what Amos said, that the blessing was coming, that the house of David, the tent of David would be rebuilt. We're seeing that. We're seeing the blessing being poured out on us. You know, there's this believing remnant turning back, being restored in Jerusalem. And then what we see Amos saying is this is going to also be a blessing to the Gentiles who are called by his name. So what we're seeing God do is exactly what he said he would do. So James says, yeah, I think it's decided. God's shown us that they don't have to be circumcised. Everybody just got together and listened to everybody else. Even those from the Pharisee party who ended up being in the wrong, they were heard. That's why they were having this discussion, because they're thinking, okay, well, let's talk about it. They did land on they were wrong, but as a community, everybody was heard. And I love what was discussed. What is God doing? And what does his word say? And they're in alignment. Oh, okay. Now we know what to do. Here's what we'll do next. That when we think of this mission we have to be a blessing to the world around us, we don't have to be overwhelmed with anxiety. We just have to remember we are blessed. He has poured out his Holy Spirit into our lives. We are receiving the promise, blessing to Abraham, that we've been tied in to this wonderful promised Holy Spirit has been poured out on us who believe. And for those of you who haven't experienced this relationship with Jesus Christ, you can right now turn to him and ask him through the sacrifice that he made for you. He gave himself up for you because he loves you. You simply ask him to take your shame from you, and that you're with him, and ask him to pour out his Holy Spirit into your lives, and it's done. He'll do it, and he'll lead you. Know that we are blessed. And then as a community, we're getting together as often as we can to hear and listen together to how is God leading us. What is he doing in your life? That's why we have so many testimonies all the time. What is God doing in your life? And how is he leading us? And what does his word have for us to say? And let's follow. And you know what's going to happen that you can look forward to, Eastside Church? If we'll do this, we'll be a blessing to our neighborhood, to our neighbors, to the world around us, to the place where we'll work. We will be a blessing because God has blessed us as part of his plan to bless the world. Will you now worship with me in song as we continue our service?
There is
Before I read the benediction, I'd just like to encourage all of you to memorize the memory verse for this week, Matthew 5:3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And that verse, just going through our heart and our head and hopefully sticking in our heart, will continue to encourage us to humbly listen to each other. That poor in spirit, one of the greatest evidences that we are poor in spirit is that we listen to each other. We don't always going to agree with each other, but we'll always respectfully listen to each other and know that we need to listen to each other. We really don't have much hope of getting it right if we don't. So please memorize that verse. And students, I'd like to have a record number of videos of blessed for the memory verses next week. And now I'm going to go ahead and read Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 and 21 as our benediction. It's how we closed out our morning prayer this morning. By the way, a wonderful way to humbly listen together. If you can call in to the 7 a.m. prayer Monday through Friday or 9 a.m. on Saturday, they are very special times. I would really fight to get that in your schedule or to keep it in your schedule if you already have. But here's our benediction, Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 and 21. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Have a wonderful week.